Hello, Malty, Merry Malt Anorak mates. I'm Ralphie, welcome to Whisky Review 561, and thank you to Murquo for that malt mention. Here's the malt, let's mention it. It's malt and unmalt, right? It's an Irish style of whisky, combining malted and unmalted barley, which gets a lot of attention and a little bit of fuss in today's malt universe. It's a style particular to Ireland, and I look forward to seeing a lot more variations and producers of this stuff, because it's interesting. It's interesting because of the quality of smell and the quality of taste, the characteristics, the personality, the things that we look for in anything that we drink of a spirity nature. This is Power's signature pure pot still whisky from Middleton Distillery, and it is basically a permutation of every other pot still whisky that is produced in Ireland, because they all come from the same distillery. Yeah. I shall nose this, taste this, tell you all about it, give you a blend mark, because it's a blend of malt and unmalted barley. And then I'll talk a little bit more about traditional Irish pot still whisky, where it's at, where it's been, and where it should be. What I tell you is, of course, as is always the case, an opinion. Roll and stroll in the glass, malt mates. Don't shake, no shaky shakies. I'll do a brief shaky shaky so as to show you what you shouldn't do. Oh yes, swirl, swirl, swirl. Oh yes. The amount of times that you see people overworking their dram, that's what it is, overworking it. Everything's happening too aggressively and too fast. The result is that the experienced is compromised. Do not follow these trendsetters. Develop good habits. Gentle, gentle. Slowly does it. This is bottled at 46%. I think there's a particular reason for that, but it certainly encouraged me to buy this. Powers is one of the well-known, well-recognised, more robust Irish whiskies, and rather tasty too. And this is really a sort of upmarket version of Powers. Powers for the connoisseur, I think. That's the marketing pitch here. And certainly, initially on the nose, we're getting a good solid arrival of fresh fruit, slightly camphorish, green apple, green note complexity. It's pretty rounded, and it's got a nice rich muscovado and slightly toffee nature to it. There's a lovely, and I find this in a lot of pot still whiskies. And in fact, quite a lot of Irish whiskies, is it's a kind of cross between green apple and plums, particularly Japanese plum wine. If you ever get an opportunity to taste that, I recommend you do so, but don't do it warm as you would with sake. Plum wine from Japan is best sipped at room temperature or very slightly chilled. Getting a sherry note coming through, some fairly modern contemporary Oloroso cask. That site is slightly toffeed. Confectionery sherry note reminds me slightly of old school Paxaret or Pacharet. You'll find it in Wikipedia if you want to know more about that. Also reminds me slightly of American rye, particularly Wild Turkey for some reason. Now, before I go much further, I'm going to actually add water. Okay, right, okay then. I'm going to be methodical. I'll taste it raw. Oh, big, sharp, young, intense arrival. Vinegary, sour, acidic. Not just acetic, it is positively acidic. And it's slightly hot. There's a little bit of burn. You'll find a burn coating the middle area of your tongue, and it lingers there. It's quite distracting, and it's slightly annoying. This really needs some water to tone it down, because, in fact, that roughness on the arrival is really compromising the calibre of the event. Again, the nose does not prepare us for the taste here. So here we go. I'm going to be reasonably generous. That's a full teaspoonful of water, minus the two drips that fell on the floor, that I've added to this Irish pot still whiskey. I'm going to stroll it round the glass a little. Now the nose is calming down initially quite quickly. Again, another sign of a relatively young whiskey. I wouldn't put this any more than about 5 or 6 years. And it seems heavily double matured, finished, I think we'd call it, rather than double matured. I get the impression that the Oloroso casks have been used to add a lot that was perhaps missing from initial maturation in first casks. Just my impression. There's some lovely fresh fruit, slightly unripe apple arrival, some apricot in there, lemongrass, lime leaf, more complex, subtle varieties of citrus fruit. There's a wee note of banana and pineapple, which is one of the characteristics of Powers. I'm still slightly undecided about this. I'm still not sure whether I like it more or like it less. But I'm giving it time. I am persevering. Taste-wise, oh, that is a lot, lot better. A lot better. The arrival is softer. More natural sugar, slight sucrose, but still with a fresh fruit, slightly mentholated, minty complexity. But then a sour note creeps into the development and it seems to linger there. It hangs about and it's a mineral sour note. It's the sour note of slightly grainy linseed putty, right? So you use for round window frames, for holding the glass into window frames. It's not visible on the nose, but it's coming through in the palate once you add water. But having said that, you need to add water to get around, to get past that initial rough development. We're giving it a bit more time now. Let's go in for a second shot. When you're getting to know a whiskey, taste less and smell more slowly, and you'll get to know it a little bit faster. Importantly, understand the pace of what you're drinking and adjust your consumption to the pace of what appears to be in the glass. It kind of sounds and a kind of awkward thing to say, but when you gain more experience, you'll spot it for yourself in whatever you're drinking. Taste. An intense sharpness in the arrival into the development, but it's interesting, it's slightly old school. I've noticed that bitterness in some independent or old school Bushmills and some other older Irish whiskies. I quite enjoy it. It adds character, but in this instance, it's a little bit too heavy, too much of a heavy presence. It's too assertive. It's too dominating. I'm going to add a little bit more water. Right, we're on to 1.5 teaspoonfuls of water. I think there was only about one drip that went in the floor that time. The nose is becoming more interesting, actually. It's settling down. It's becoming more natural because the Oloroso brown sugar muscovado toffee-ish overcoat is lifting off now. It's weakening. And to be honest, I think that's a good thing. Taste-wise, that's a lot better. A lot, lot better. The sourness is toning down. That slightly flat spot mineral note in the development is receding, but what it's leaving is a shorter development and a vague finish. And again, I'm getting a slight afterburn of heat, which one tends to associate with speedy distillation. That's just my impressions. I'm not making statements here. I can only give you my own personal impression, and hopefully it's going to be useful to you. But in terms of marks, I'll have one more taste before I give my final mark. You know, I do get the impression ...81 out of 100, it's a blend mark. As I was saying, I do get the impression that this is the pot still whiskey that didn't quite cut quality control for the Redbreast bottlings. It's an opinion. Old style, traditional pot still Irish whiskey is a style of Irish whiskey that practically died out until Jamesons continued to make some so as to have a variety of flavour whiskey to add to the proprietary blends to give it character and a certain distinctiveness. And you'll notice this particularly in Jameson's Crested 10, which in my opinion is one of the finest Jamesons bottled. It is distinctive, it's different from Scotch whisky. It has these what you call green notes, your kiwi fruit, green banana, green apple, plum, slight savoury notes and vegetal notes, avocado. Occasionally you get some slight spinach or broccoli green vegetable notes. And when you become familiar with it, it's a style and flavour that you really warm to, because as true whisky drinkers, we appreciate authentic, original character. A flavour that delivers itself successfully that we can't really find anywhere else. It's not generic. It's not particularly engineered. It just happens to be, and that's where the success of it lies. And Middleton have, they do no doubt about it, produce some fabulous pot still whisky. And it's a style that I first encountered about 15 years ago through a bottle of Green Spot 10-year-old. In fact, I don't think it even had an age statement at that point, which could only be sourced from a licensed grocer in Dublin by the name of Mitchell's, until it made its way across to the very, very earliest offerings of the online retailers. And when I first tasted the Green Spot, I was smitten, actually, because I knew I was looking for a style of Irish whiskey which was not smooth, accessible and anemic. I was looking for a richer, more complex character, which I know full well that Irish whiskey is capable of being. And I knew that because I'd, over the years I've had a few poachings, which have been, frankly, fabulous, amazing, beautifully crafted, characterful, flavour-rich whiskies, which are nothing like your generic big brands. So I know that style's out there. I know that character's out there. And it was thereafter that we had more permutations of this pot still character, most famously in the Redbreast bottlings, first the 15-year-old and then the 12, which have in the past been very memorable, worthwhile whiskies. But as the genre has caught on, we're noticing these, well, John's Lane version. It was quite heavily sherried, and it's kind of featured, it held its own quite successfully, but here with the Powers version signature, I do think we're getting something underneath its capabilities, and it's nothing to, well, it is partly to do with the distillate and partly to do with the calibre of maturation. It's not a bad whiskey, but it's not one I would rush out to buy again. And I really think that with the sudden arrival of craft and small distilleries throughout Ireland, to explore this style would be a very sound investment, and to do so in terms of flavour, character, clean distillation and good quality maturation would be another very sound investment. And I look forward to seeing some variations on the themes set by Middleton, who, to their credit, have kept the flame alive for Irish traditional pot still whiskey, and in fact have provided our first experience. And I say that to Jameson's credit. It's interesting that there's a whole genre here of spirits which any serious producer would be well worthwhile exploring, and that is when you combine a malted and unmalted grain, whatever that grain may be, what are the results going to be, and how does that relate to peated versions? Because there is no reason why you cannot peat unmalted grain, none at all, although it's very much tends to be part of a malting or a kilning process after malting. But there are ways around it, and the simpler the methodology, the better the results, so I'm told. Irish whiskies on the doorstep of a whole new generation of potentials. We'll wait and see how it goes. We'll wait and see as to whether the industry is overly conservative and overly bound by the fashions of the moment, or whether they have faith in intrinsic quality alone and are prepared to believe that in the future, when the product's ready, if the character's there and the flavour, whatever they might that may be, then there will be a willing and receptive audience of customers, not passive consumers, no malt mates, us, you and I, active, proactive customers, who are waiting to see whether it's going to be accessible, that it's not going to be overpriced and overpackaged and grotesquely overmarketed, but whether it's going to be delivered authentically, originally, cleanly, carefully, thoughtfully and precisely into our radar. anyway, there we go, malt mates. I'm going to conclude by saying thank you to all you malt mates who have subscribed to my Patreon channel. I've put a wee link below. I really appreciate that. I'll be making a wee statement in that soon and on my Facebook page. And also, malt mates, if you haven't yet subscribed to Ralphie Staff here on YouTube, please do so. And therefore, you will not miss on out in the happenings, the malty happenings, malt moments and other assorted stuff. Anyway, I'm Ralphie. Choo-choo. It is time for the malt train to head off on another journey. If you're over at Glasgow's Whisky Festival, and this is kind of time sensitive, I'll see you there. And bye bye for now. Choo choo. How do you work this bloody thing? That's better. Train whistle. I don't drive trains, so. Yeah, there we go. I saw it on eBay when I was browsing and I thought, you know, it's not expensive. I'd like one of them. And I'm going to keep it forever as a souvenir. Yeah.